Hi, Brittany Ann from Equipping Godly Women here, and I have a question for you. Do you ever feel just tired or weary or worn out? Like you probably don't get enough sleep, you have so much to do, you're just stressed and overwhelmed, and you just know you're not living the best life that you could be. Well, if so, you're in for a treat, because today we are interviewing Dr. Saundra Dalton Smith, author of the book, Sacred Rest, Recover Your Life, Renew Your Energy, Restore Your Sanity, and owner of the site, ichoosemybestlife.com. Today, we're talking to Saundra about what it looks like when we don't get enough rest in our lives, the seven types of rest that every woman needs. I bet you don't know what all seven of them are. And then just a ton of super practical tips that we can use in order to figure out which areas of rest we might be deficient in, and then how we can actually get more of this rest in our lives, no matter how busy we are or how much we have on our plates. So if you are ready to get more rejuvenating soul rest in your life, I really hope you'll stay tuned to this interview coming up right now. All right, so today we have Saundra Dalton Smith with us, author of the book, Sacred Rest, Recover Your Life, Renew Your Energy, Restore Your Sanity. Thank you so much, Saundra, for meeting with us today.
Thanks for having me.
So can you start us off by telling us a little bit about your book? What prompted you to write it, or do you have some kind of backstory that made this topic important to you?
Yeah, the book really started with my own personal journey of learning how to come out of being in a, I wouldn't necessarily say depressed, but I would probably say more of a depleted state, because it went so much further than just depression, because it hit every aspect of my life. My physical well-being was suffering, was tired all the time, my muscles always ached, and really what I discovered was that I was burned out. And when I got to that point, what happened was I had to make a decision. You know, it was either I was going to continue to just spiral down, or I was going to try to decide how to improve that. And I didn't think pills were going to be the answer, because it wasn't a typical type chemical depression. It was more just a life out of control. And so that's where the book started, learning how to figure out how to allow God and his teachings, and getting back to some of the key principles that he's laid down for how we can improve ourselves and how we can keep ourselves healthy, happy, and whole, to just start getting back to that.
On your book, I noticed that it said that you are a doctor. I'm just curious, what type of doctor are you, or what do you do?
I'm an internal medicine physician. Internal medicine is 18 years and older. I go to the emergency room. I follow my patients to the ICU. I'm a regular medical doctor.
That is awesome. So in your book description, it mentions that your book contains scientific research on the area of rest. Can you share a little bit with us about what sort of research you found, or what kind of statistics you came across?
Yeah, it actually was a statistic that really started off my own journey into looking at how to improve my patients' lives and how to be of more benefit to them as their physician. I started looking at studies because so many people were complaining about their life just not being what they had dreamed or what they had aspired to. And one of the studies I came across talked about people, when they asked them over the next 5 years how they felt their lives would look, if they thought it would be improving, if they thought it would be struggling, kind of what did they, were their levels of expectation. And over 55% of the people who were surveyed, and this is a large national survey, 55% of the people said that in a 5 years, they thought that their life would be struggling. And that was just heartbreaking to me to look at that statistic, because that meant if I'm sitting in the room with a few people, over half of them have no hope. They don't feel like their lives are going to get any better. And if anything, they think it's going to be worse than how it is right now.
Yeah, that's so interesting. I love statistics too. And that is really surprising to me that such a high number of people would not expect that their life would be getting better. In your own practice, did you have a lot of people who were coming to you just weary and burnt out? Is that something you were seeing all the time?
I was, but I wasn't looking at it from that standpoint, because people would come in and they'd just say they're tired all the time. And so that's still, you know, in medicine, one of the number one things that people show up complaining of. They're either tired all the time, or they can't sleep, or they have headaches and chronic back and neck pain. You know, the pain epidemic's a big issue right now. So all of those were things that I see on a regular basis, but I had never really put it together with burnout or overwhelm or even with the rest deficit until I started experiencing it myself.
Yeah, I feel like that's something that so many of us do struggle with to the point where we think it's normal. We're like, oh, well, we're moms, or oh, well, we're working, so of course we're tired all the time. Not even questioning that that shouldn't be normal in our lives. So let me ask you, as you started to walk through this yourself to realize that you were burnout, what kind of first steps did you start taking to fix that in your life?
Well, the very first thing was determining what area I think was that I was having the biggest problem. Because when I first started looking at this, I think like most people, I hit at it from a standpoint that I must just need more sleep. So I'm going to focus on getting 7 to 8 hours of sleep every day, you know, for the next month. And so I did that, but I'm still tired all the time. I felt some better, but I didn't really feel like I should if that was the problem. I still felt depleted as far as emotionally and even spiritually. So I knew that there were other issues than just sleep. Because the key scripture that kept coming back to me was from Isaiah 30, where it's talking about God talking with the Israelites about the promises he's given them and about how they have felt like those promises are to come from the own works of their hand, the sweat of their brow, their own effort, striving. And really, that's where I was. I was where I felt like I had to grind it out on God's behalf. You know, whatever I felt that he had impassioned me to do, that it was my role to grind out the results. And that scripture really brought me back to, there's a very key principle that it talks about in Isaiah 30:15, where it says, and you know, in quietness and trust shall be your strength. And I thought, do I trust God enough to rest? And I didn't. I didn't, because my life reflected that. And I love the very last line of that scripture. It talks about, in returning in rest shall you be saved, but you would have none of it. And that was such a convicting verse for me, because he was right. It wasn't that I didn't know what to do, because obviously the Sabbath and resting is a part of God's plan. I mean, it's one of the commandments they tell us not to forget. I think because he knew we were going to forget it. So it's actually telling us not to forget it, but we don't. We reject it because it's so countercultural. And that became my truth. That became the life that I was living. And I started living under the punishment, so to speak, of that, because I wasn't returning to what he was offering. And so that was the big part of the journey for me, was learning how to trust God enough to rest.
And I can totally relate to that. That's something that I have definitely dealt with as I've done my ministry at Equipping Godly Women, to try to find that balance of, okay, God has called me to do this ministry and to do things, and I want to work hard and I want to, you know, go at it with all my might, but how do I trust and how does that look like? But there was something else I wanted to ask you. You mentioned a minute ago that there were multiple kinds of rest, that you were getting enough sleep, but that wasn't enough, and there were other areas. Can you tell us what are the 7 areas of rest and kind of what each of them looks like?
Yeah, the 7 types. Well, physical is one of them. And that's where sleep gets grouped in at, because sleep is a type of physical rest, but it's a passive type of physical rest. And so we divide the physical up into the passive and the active. And active physical rest are things like massage or dynamic stretching exercises, gentle walking and gentle aerobic exercise, not walking for weight loss, but just that kind of walking to improve circulation and get the lymphatics flowing. All of those are under the physical rest title. Then we also have mental rest, emotional rest, social rest, spiritual rest, creative rest, and sensory rest. So those are the 7 types. And mental rest, I think most people have some concept of, but it really is that kind of ongoing mind chatter that a lot of us have, turning that off. And so for some, that may look like taking blocks of time where you experience silence and you quiet your mind instead of letting it ruminate over things. That's particularly helpful for a lot of people at bedtime. If you are one who tries to go to sleep at night and you run through your to-do list for the next morning, or you go through the woulda, coulda, shoulda conversations that you wanted to have during the day, but maybe didn't say exactly how you wanted to say it during in the moment. So it's learning how to turn that part off. Emotional rest is about really just being authentic and dropping the people-pleasing behaviors that are very common in particularly Christian women, not wanting to offend or hurt or erect their personal boundaries because of the confrontational nature of them. Social rest has to do with surrounding yourself with those people who are life-giving to you. It's that camaraderie, that kind of sisterhood with other ladies where you're spending time around them and you're allowing their presence to bless you. Spiritual rest, I think, is pretty obvious. That for me, that goes not specifically with religion, because religion has a lot of laws and rules and things, but it's really more about the relationship that we have with God. It's that time in his presence. It's the kind of seeing him as someone that we have a relationship with, spending time in prayer and in his word. And then there's sensory rest that has to do with this, our senses, which can include things like making sure you're not staring at the computer screen for long periods of time. You're not getting a lot of blue light from the screens before you try to go to bed. You're being conscious of the background noises that you surround yourself with. You know, a lot of people don't spend any time in silence, so they can't get mental rest because they never have quiet around them. And so it's making sure that you create those moments where you have some sensory rest. And that also includes your smells, because, you know, if you're working in an office, you may have 10 people wearing 10 different perfumes or colognes. And so you don't really realize how all these different things kind of play into how your body feels kind of chronically toxic. And then last is creative rest, which has to do with allowing ourselves to be awakened and in awe of beauty. And that includes the natural beauty that we see just outside with flowers and the ocean and mountains and things like that, as well as created beauty that we see when we are maybe looking at a piece of art or listening to great music. And it's allowing that to kind of awaken something in us.
That is a lot of different kinds of rest. And I'm so glad that you broke them all down for us, because so many of those things I wouldn't have even thought of. Like some I know for me, things like sounds I am more sensitive to. So that's something that I know for me, but other areas wouldn't have even crossed my mind. So for anybody who is listening who knows that they're tired or worn out or weary all of the time and thinks maybe one of these could be the reason, how can they figure out which area they need the most help with?
Absolutely. And that's why I came up with an assessment to be able to help people, because it is hard to determine which of the seven types you might be deficient in. And most people are surprised by their results, because the one they're deficient in is one that they have ignored. They may not even know about. So what I created was an online assessment that they can take at restquiz.com. It's a free rest assessment. At the end of it, it asks for your email and it sends you back a detailed report that shows you which of the seven types of rest you're most efficient in, and then give some ideas about kind of what that means for you.
So after someone takes this test, it would tell them what areas they're deficient in, their levels, but does it also go in and give more ideas for what they can do for each of their areas?
I discuss a lot of that in the book Sacred Rest, as far as going through a lot of different options for what different people could use for the different types of rest recovery, because everybody's so different. And honestly, what one person requires to improve, let's say creative rest, would be completely different from someone else. So I give a couple of different options, because it is individualized. It's not really a cookie cutter kind of format. I did do a 30-day sacred rest challenge that I make available on my website for free under the resources section. It gives just very quick tips over a 30-day period. I mean, it's literally like one or two sentences about something you can do to try to improve rest in all the seven areas, because it goes through all seven areas over the 30 days. And I found that to be kind of where I direct most people, because it's, like I said, most people, even if there's one key area that they're really struggling in, everyone benefits from learning kind of how to live a more restful lifestyle. And we're talking very simple things that doesn't, you know, not going to take more than 5 minutes, because the goal in recovering through kind of incorporating these restful activities isn't to further add things to the to-do list. It's really to kind of help you look at your daily lifestyle flow and see how can you use what you're already doing to actually become a recovery step. Because you're talking simple things. If you're working out of your desk for 7, 8 hours, you know, for whatever reason, you might be writing a book and kind of staying in the groove for a while writing, or you might be at a desk job. Something as simple as doing flow break cycles, where you work for a period and then you purposely take a break to practice body fluidity, to make sure that your muscles aren't tight, that your eyes are level with the screen, that your hands are in the right position, so that if you do feel pain when you take your break, you analyze, okay, why are my wrists hurting? Okay, I've got bad posture with how my hands are touching the keyboard. You adjust it in the moment so that at the end of the 8 hours, you don't end up with carpal tunnel killing you because you failed to actually assess your body till you finished 8 hours later. You're actively assessing as you go and making those minute adjustments so that you finish the day still feeling good.
So I'm glad that you mentioned that they are just really, for a lot of them at least, really simple things that we can do, because I would imagine for somebody who's feeling just so tired and overwhelmed, you just don't have the energy to go do all these crazy big changes in your life. But if it's just simple things that you can do, and I've even started to do some of them in my own life since we met a few months ago and I first heard you talk about the different areas of rest, to try to, you know, make sure I have that time with good godly girlfriends where we can encourage each other and to make sure that I'm taking breaks when I'm working. And it really does help. So I'm going to make sure definitely that I link all these resources that you have mentioned in the show notes so that anybody can check them out, go through the assessment, definitely get the book so that you aren't dealing with all these little things that you don't need to deal with if you just had some quick and easy tips that would make a big difference. So I wanted to ask you just a few more really practical questions for somebody who's really interested in this and wants to start making these changes but is kind of unsure about how they would go about it. So the first one that I wanted to ask you is, with all of us so busy, how do we even find the time to start making these changes? I know some of them you said are as simple as adjusting posture, but other things I'm sure would take more time. You said for more sleep. How in the world, for moms who are already feel like, you know, they don't get enough sleep and they don't get everything done, how do they find time for more sleep or find time to go out with girlfriends when they already feel like they can't handle what they have?
I usually start with the sleep aspect that you mentioned, because for most women, it's not just getting more sleep, it's getting higher quality sleep. The problem is so many moms in particular never get into deep sleep. They have mommy sleep, where they sleep very lightly so that they can wake up and go chase people down and, you know, pat people on the back and all those things that they need to do in the middle of the night if someone wakes up. So even after their kids are big enough to not wake up in the middle of the night, a lot of women still keep that very light sleep. So they don't get into stage 3 and 4, where the restorative sleep is. So I usually start with that. And what we do is we basically carve out just 10 minutes before going to bed to start doing some of these restful activities, to do the body analysis. What's hurting? What does your body feel like? Because oftentimes when people lay in the bed and they toss and turn, that the part of the reason is either, number one, their body's achy and they don't understand why, but that achy body makes it uncomfortable to find a comfortable sleeping position, or their mind's racing and they can't get it to shut up long enough for them to actually to go into a deeper level of sleep. So we address those things before we ever even hit the bed. We start analyzing of the body. If there's an area that seems tense or tight, evaluate what could have happened during that day to cause it. Sometimes young moms don't realize that picking up a 20-pound toddler, for them, they don't think too much about it, but that's weightlifting all day long. And so you do need to stretch those muscles back out, or they're likely going to get tight and tense over time. Also, younger moms tend to have a lot of problems with sensory overload. If they have kids that are screaming or pitching a fit or crying, all of those are high-pitched sounds, and they can really wreck your nerves over the long haul. And so, yes, you love your kids, and no, you want, you know, you don't want to muffle them, but we have to realize that that does have a side effect on how our bodies feel. And so to take that time to shut off the TV and shut off the extra sounds and turn off the worship music, because it's still extra sound. And so there's a time period where you have to allow your senses, whichever senses are getting overwhelmed, to have a time to detox. And so for, let's say, a simple routine for someone might be doing a simple body analysis. Okay, my neck hurts. I'm going to do a quick self-massage to kind of loosen that up. You might even incorporate your husband in there to say, do you mind giving me a neck rub here or whatever. You can include with that a little bit of silence. The mind, if your mind has a tendency to race because you're thinking about, oh, I got to make sure I pack this lunchbox for somebody in the morning, or I need to make sure to get this done in the morning. And so that's running around in your thought processes and keeping you from being able to actually sleep because you're thinking about it, to go ahead and do what we call mind dumping, which is to have just a piece of scrap paper or something by the bedside, a notebook, whatever you like, to be able to write those kind of thoughts down. Because the brain, once you write it down and you put it on something concrete, it's almost like permission to let it go because it knows it's safe. It's contained now. So it doesn't have to try to keep it up here because now it's here. And so those are just some simple things to start with and to try to start teaching your body, your mind, and even your spirit, because I highly recommend for women who feel like sometimes they feel kind of disconnected from God is to make sure that right before they go to bed that they do have a time of prayer so that they reconnect that kind of mind, body, and spirit, just those top three.
So let me ask you a little bit of a different question then. What about the issue of guilt? Because I know as moms, so many of us, and even you don't have to be a mom. If you are a Christian woman, you know about guilt and the whole people-pleasing thing. But it's like, okay, I should be resting. It's a Sunday. I should, you know, go do whatever it is that's going to be restorative to my soul. How do I overcome the guilt of going and doing something for myself when I know at home I have dishes to do, I have laundry to do, I have family that needs me to get them ready for the week? How do we even address that?
Well, I think it's first just looking at what is the benefit of you being well rested. You know, sometimes we look at those type of things as being selfish when we take time for ourselves, but if you're at your best, does that not benefit your family more? You know, when I discuss this with moms and they'll say, I feel guilty. And I'll say, well, do you feel guilty when you snap at your kids because you're stressed out? We feel guilty about that too. So there's plenty of reasons to feel guilty if we allow them. But to feel guilty because you are allowing yourself to be better, you're opening yourself to being able to be recovered and restored, and you're actually following a biblical principle that has been laid out in scripture as how God intends for you to have healing and to maintain strength, there can be no guilt in that, because all of that is going to lead you to be a better mom, a better wife, and a better Christian, because you will be more prepared to do whatever he's asking you to do. You won't be drained. You won't be run down. You won't feel depleted, because this is his path for you living your best life. This is his path for leading you to abundance. It's his path for strengthening you. And it requires trust. And so part of that trust is understanding that it is not selfish. It is actually the way in which you become your best self.
Would you recommend doing something where you say, okay, I'm going to trust God, that I'm going to set this time aside, and you just like block off on your calendar, these are the hours that I'm going to do it? Or would you recommend more easing into it, where people would start with just small things during the day and add up and kind of work up to it?
Most people who are high achievers or very busy or already feel overwhelmed, to try to block off a period of time, it seems overwhelming. So I typically recommend that people start with one small change. So let's say if someone has a social rest deficit, I'd have them start with something as simple as do a FaceTime with your girlfriend for a 5-minute coffee a couple of times a week.
So another thing I wanted to ask you, and this is honestly like a question of mine that I've been trying to come up with some kind of answer to in my own life over the last several months, is how do we know what actually counts as rest and what counts as work? And it feels like a silly question. But earlier when you were talking about physical rest, you were saying about how walking can actually count as rest. And I know in my life, like equipping godly women, writing things and doing these things, I love my job. And so I always struggle with like, where is the boundary between these things are life-giving to me, but it's also work. And do you have any kind of guidelines for how we can tell the difference between we are truly resting or if we are still working?
Yes, and I love that question, because one gentleman actually asked me, he's like, you know, when I go chop wood, he goes, I feel so much better mentally, emotionally, spiritually, in every way when I go out in the woods by myself and chop wood. And he's like, is that rest or is it work? I'm like, well, physically you're working, you know, your body's chopping. I was like, well, what are you thinking about? And what is the surroundings? He's like, the whole time I'm looking at the wood and I'm appreciating it. He's getting creative rest of the moment because he's looking at the kind of the design and what all of that means and contemplating it. He's having spiritual moment because he says he was praying during that time. You know, it kind of brings him kind of in a deeper understanding of kind of how our lives are kind of interconnected when he's doing all of this. And then he talked about how he does it in silence. The only sound he hears is the chopping of the wood. So every time he's kind of stops or in between the chops, there's silence that's surrounding him. And then he talked about my mind goes blank because I'm on a single focus. And usually my mind is scattered in 100 ways. But when it's on that single focus of chopping that wood and narrowing it down, and it really made me think, just like you said, you can be resting in other areas while working in one area. And I see that for myself when I'm writing. I'm working in that I am contemplating and putting thoughts together and all of that. But I'm also having oftentimes some spiritual rest because I'm studying God's word in the process. So I leave, how I define rest is that you leave the moment feeling something has been restored. When you're working, you leave the moment you can tell you've used energy into whatever that was. So work uses the energy, rest restores the energy. And you can be doing both at the same time.
That's so interesting that you put it that way. And my wheels are just turning about the analogy of resting in one way and working in another way. Because for me, I've always kind of had the mindset of those are two totally different things. Like you're working, and when you're working hard, and then you're resting. So I'm like, okay, Monday through Friday, I'm going to work super hard. And then on Sundays, somehow I'm just going to sit and I'm going to rest and I'm going to do nothing. And those are the worst. I hate Sunday afternoons when I try to do that because that's not restorative to me to just sit there. I hate doing that. I don't know. I'm just not wired that way.
And that's not rest. That's not rest. And that's the misconception. That's why most of the world is burned out and 55% of them feel like it's hopeless because what they think is rest is just ceasing activity. It is not rest. If there's nothing being restored, then laying on the couch watching Netflix is not rest. It's just different type of work.
And that is so encouraging because I hate, my husband is happy to sit on the couch and watch golf. And I'm just like over here, like about to pull my hair out. Like I do not want to sit and watch TV. I hate it. But that's besides the point.
So for me, rest is more of a lifestyle. I'll take a half day where maybe 4 hours, I'll do things that are restorative to me. And that might be a walk around the lake that's here in our area. That's oftentimes part of it for the physical rest aspect. That might be sitting for a time with silence, just praying and kind of communing with God inside or out, depending on what the weather looks like here in the South. That can include something along the lines of having a time where I get on FaceTime or something, Skype or something like that with a girlfriend to do a prayer time or to just chat. So all of those are part of it. And it really depends on kind of what's going on with you. And I think that's a big part of rest is really for each person to get back in touch with what you feel like when you're at your best. Because I think so often we get used to what we feel like now when everything is stressed and strained and kind of under this chronic toxicity that we accept that as good as it gets. And so once you start incorporating more rest and once you start feeling what it feels like to not have your neck muscles up in your ears, what it feels like not to be under chronic eye strain, what it feels like to lay in the bed and actually go into deep sleep and wake up the next morning feeling energized and ready to start your day, what it feels like to have your kids running around screaming and you don't have the desire to scream back at them because you're not on the edge of your nerves. Once you start feeling what that feels like, it's very easy to tell when you're being pulled away from it.
Yeah, that is so inspiring just to think of we really can feel that way and just how amazing that is going to feel once we start putting these steps into place in our lives. Well, thank you, Saundra, so much for being willing to take time out of your busy schedule and come talk to us today. This has been so encouraging to me just to kind of wrap my brain around what that looks like and how I can incorporate more strategies into my life, just practically speaking. And I'm sure our readers have loved it too. So thank you so much for your time today.
Thanks. So great talking with you.
All right. So that about wraps up this interview. If you want to enter to win the giveaway that Saundra is doing of her book, sacred rest, recover your life, renew your energy, restore your sanity. Go ahead and scroll down now and find the link in the description. It's going to take you to where you can enter the giveaway, as well as links to all of the different resources that we mentioned in this interview. Then, once you've done that, make sure you subscribe to this channel if you haven't already. Every week, I am coming back and bringing you more videos and more interviews with some awesome Christian women so that we can really dive in to what this Christian life should look like and how we can live it out well. So if this is the kind of content that you need in your life to encourage you and challenge you and equip you, I really hope that you will subscribe right now, and I'll see you back here soon. Bye!